Welcome to the ninth video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. We're now going to describe the material that forms part two of the book. We're finished with the conceptual ideas and the conceptual part of the book, and we're moving on to what I call quantum operator mechanics. The second part contains eight chapters that are going to develop the formalism for quantum mechanics. It actually forms the largest part of the book. Starting with spin, we then motivate the canonical commutation relation. We find states of definite position and momentum, and we describe the general energy eigenvalue problem. The formalism is aided by using Dirac notation to describe the abstract quantum states. The first chapter is a mathematical interlude to teach you some of the basics that are needed. We need to know properties of the exponential function, the Euler identity, complex numbers. We need to know a little bit about matrices, what eigenvalues and eigenvectors are, and so forth. We also introduce a little bit of Dirac notation. Don't be afraid about the math that is in here. The most complicated math it requires is the quadratic equation for doing matrices. It does work with series for working with the exponential function, but really all you need to have seen is the binomial theorem. If you've seen the binomial theorem, you're ready to go and work on all of the stuff that we've seen. If you've never seen complex numbers, you are going to need to learn them, and we have a section that covers that as well. Next chapter is on spin. We use some careful arguments to describe why we need operators to describe spin and how they're represented in terms of what are called Pauli spin matrices. We then develop a generalized Euler identity, very similar to the Euler identity for complex numbers, but a little bit different because it involves matrices now. We then derive the SU2 exponential disentangling identity. Most of you have never seen this, even if you've taken lots of quantum mechanics classes. I had been doing research in quantum mechanics for at least 20 years before I'd even heard of it, but it's a really powerful thing and everyone should know about it. We then determine how to find quantum states that have definite spin in any particular direction. Then in the next chapter, we move on to the harmonic oscillator. That requires us to get the canonical commutation relation and work with states that have definite position and momentum. We develop the factorization method to find energy eigenstates. And for those of you who've, again, taken quantum mechanics, you will be surprised about a number of the subtleties of the factorization method and learn some new things you'd never heard of before. We examine uncertainty, coherent states, squeeze states, and a lot more. And then we move on to the next chapter, which summarizes our operator identities. These are the four workhorses for our calculations. They include the Leibniz identity, the product identity for commutators, the Hadamard lemma, which allows us to do similarity transformations using exponential operators of operators, the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula, which allows us to take the product of two exponentials and make it into one exponential, and the exponential disentangling identities, which allow us to evaluate exponentials of objects that form part of a Lie group in terms of other Lie group elements, and it's a very powerful identity. Then we have a chapter on angular momentum. We examine rotations, we define states of definite angular momentum, we discuss how you can combine angular momentum. We examine one of the favorite things that I have in this book, the derivation that I worked out with Mark Weitzman on spherical harmonics. I think it's a really cool way to do the derivation, and I think it also really helps you understand what spherical harmonics actually are. We then learn how to represent angular momentum using harmonic oscillators. This is a really cool idea that was developed by Julian Schwinger, the same Julian Schwinger who invented quantum electrodynamics, along with two other people. We then move on to interacting spin models that allows us to put our angular momentum to work. We introduce the Ising model and the XY model. We use fermionization to solve these models. This actually brings us into our first foray into second quantization, looking at fermionic operators. We then examine more complicated systems, including the Lipkin-Meshkov-Glick model, which was applied into nuclear physics, and the Dickey model, which is something that is actively being explored now in ion traps. Next up is the big one, hydrogen. We develop the factorization method in general. We show how you separate variables and include the definition of the radial momentum. And then we combine all of these ideas together to the point where we can solve for the energy eigenstates of hydrogen. We examine the wave functions of hydrogen in both position space and momentum space being particularly important for the next bullet because it is how we actually image hydrogen. So the interesting experiments we look at is how deuterium was discovered. This essentially allows you to measure the weight of the nucleus by doing spectroscopy. We also talk about the proton charge radius, which allows you to measure the physical size of the nucleus by doing spectroscopy. The E2E experiment or E2E spectroscopy is a way that we actually get an image of hydrogen in momentum space. We then look at radio astronomy and the Lamb shift and much more. Now, a particle in a box in a conventional treatment of quantum mechanics is often viewed as one of the simplest problems, although it has lots of mathematical subtlety to it that is often swept under the rug and can come to bite you if you're not familiar with what those subtleties are, but they're usually not taught. Here, with the factorization method, it's actually a pretty difficult problem to solve, and Schrödinger called it shooting sparrows with artillery. So we go through in detail how we do it, and this is why it appears so late in this section. In this chapter, we also have a discussion about why we have bound states and when we have bound states, and that's an interesting problem for any particular potential to be able to answer those questions. We also discuss a number of other philosophical issues about quantum mechanics related to measurement and what wave functions are and so forth. There's some quite interesting stuff that you'll be able to wrap your head around in this chapter. And that's kind of it. Those are the chapters 5 through 12 cover part 2. I just wanted to reiterate some of the experiments. If you ever wanted to know what an atom looks like, this is a picture of an atom. This is the E2E spectroscopy. The line is the exact calculation. The symbols are the experimental data. You can see it does a remarkable job. It might be a little bit of a letdown to know that that's a picture. It's in momentum space, which is a little hard to wrap your head around, but we'll have lots of discussions about what that means and explain it in a clear fashion for you. Another really cool experiment is radio astronomy. This is two pictures of a galaxy. The one on the left is using visual telescopes. The one on the right is using radio telescopes. The radio telescopes can measure the density of hydrogen in the galaxy, and that then allows them to do things like measure how fast the galactic arms are spinning. This was a key element in determining the fact that there must be dark matter and probably also dark energy, but I'm not a huge expert in astronomy to know exactly what the experiments were for dark energy. But for sure, these are the experiments that were used for dark matter. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.